Feeling okay out there? Everybody's good? Everybody's good? Want to hear the fish is doing something bad story? I'm not telling that again. I told that last story. You guys know that one? I will follow up a story from last tour very quickly, just because I feel like I have to put an addendum to last tour. I was out here and I was talking about being a doomsday prepper, which I am, and I was telling this story about the fact that my doomsday prepping has gotten completely out of control, and I need to. It's stupid now. My whole apartment is full of, like, you know, dried food and, you know, anti-nuclear bomb juice and stuff. But anyway, the point of the story was that Fish's wife, Briar, is a much better doomsday prepper than me. And we had a prep off, and she won because she has a cow, right? Think about it. You know? So I was kind of saying to her, do you have the gas masks? And she's like, yeah, I got the gas mask. But then she said, I have the cow, so I win. So the reason I wanted to start off this tour by following up on that story was because I went up to visit Fish not too long ago. And he lives in Lincolnville, Maine. He has a beautiful farm and 5 kids, and they have animals and stuff. And I was going to find Briar's wife to say hi. And I went out, and she was in the barn and with the cow, right? The aforementioned cow. And her friend, like, I walked in the barn, and it was Briar and her friend. And her friend had her arm all the way up the cow's, like, to the shoulder of the cow's. It wasn't the butt, but it was the other part of the cow. And with, like, a big rubber glove that went all the way up to her shoulder. And I saw, that was when I came around the corner, that was the scene that I walked into. And I said, Briar, why does your friend have her arm up the cow? And she said, to see if the cow is pregnant, right? You guys are probably thinking, my God, is he really this stupid that he doesn't know this? But I did. And so I said, it was like Briar and her friend and then this old Maine farmer and a couple of other farmer guy types. And then here comes me. And I said, why do you need to know if the cow's pregnant? And they all kind of looked at me like I was a complete moron. And they said, are you serious? And I said, yeah, no, really, why do you need to check if the cow's pregnant? And they said, it's because cows don't give milk if they're not pregnant. Now, did you know that? Because I had no idea. Is anybody else going to let me off the hook? Did anybody not know? I thought cows just gave milk. I was flabbergasted. I never knew. I thought there were just cows all over the place giving milk. But apparently they have to get pregnant first. Anyway. Thanks. Somebody must have been in my, somebody else must have not known that. Thank you for not knowing that. Oh, God. All right, let me go play some songs now. I don't even know what I'm doing. Just give me a second. Let me play one of my favorites here. Yeah. I love this one. Factoid here. A couple little factoids. One is that I was talking to Paige this morning. He grew up about in Basking Ridge, right next to him. So he told me to shout it out, so I'm shouting it out for him. I got to spend time before his parents moved from that house. I got to hang out with Paige a number of times. And it's a very beautiful house. Lived there with his brother and sister. Yep. You know. And so we had a few, you know, sad things that happened in the last week or so. And so I'll dedicate this song. I'm not just going to dedicate it to, first of all, for those of you who don't know, Paige's father did pass away last week, or a couple days ago. Great, just amazing guy. And I'm just, you know, sharing this information without dipping down into too much sadness, but it's also my sister's birthday today. She also moved on to, we lost her a few years ago. And some of you might have read that I said goodbye to one of my best friends. So I'm going to dedicate this not just to the three of them, but considering the fact that I was thinking backstage that since there's three very dear people in my own life, that pretty much guarantees that most of the people in this room can relate to similar things in their life. So I will send this out to your loved ones. You guys ever heard of the, I just heard about this the other day. I think about this weird stuff, but you ever heard of the tongue-eating louse? No. Oh, good. I'm so glad. God, I'm as glad that you don't know what the tongue-eating louse is as that some of you didn't know that cows needed to be pregnant to make milk. The tongue-eating louse is a parasite, okay, that climbs in. And by the way, when I'm done with the story, when you go home, please look this up because you got to see the picture. But the tongue-eating louse climbs in the gills of the fish, right? Big fish get these things, and it attaches itself, and then it eats the fish's tongue, and then it lives in the fish's mouth. It's like another head in the fish's mouth, and all the food that goes into the fish, the tongue-eating louse eats. The fish starves and dies. That's the tongue-eating louse. So, like, you've got a big problem today. You woke up, you're like, oh, man, I got to talk to that guy. I got to do that thing at work. But you don't have a tongue-eating louse. So, it's a great day. What was I doing? How about, I'll tell you a story while he brings it up. This is it. This is a fun one. One time we were playing in Atlanta, not at the place we play now, but at the other one. Now we play, the first one was Lakewood, right? The more wooden, older one. And Lakewood's kind of in like a little sketchier neighborhood. Is that right? Okay. I'm trying to say that, you know. So like, we play the show. This is a completely true story. And we're playing out there and we're like doing some encore or something. Like, jumping around. You know, everyone's screaming and like we're jumping up and down sweating. And we go running off stage. You know, me and Paige and Mike and Fish, we like run into the band room. And then right, the phone rang. There's a phone. There's always a phone in the band room. Okay? Which, I don't know why it's there. It's like nobody uses it. It's like there's phones in band rooms. But I don't know, maybe there's some kind of connection. I didn't think there were actual phones that you could call out on. But, you know, line phones for talking on. Phones for talking on. Anyway, we run off stage at Lakewood, running. And I run in the band room and the phone rings. Ring! You know? And I pick up the phone, I say, band room, Trey talking, right? And it's this woman, and she's like almost in tears, very heavy Southern accent. And she says, I just called because my son called, and his name was Peyton. And I said, what's your last name, ma'am? And she said, my last name is Hooten, his name was Peyton Hooten, okay? And she said, my son just called me from the venue. It's his first concert. He's like a teenager. And he'd never been to a concert before. And he lost his friends. And I'm panicked because he's 16 years old or something like that. And he sounds like something, he was sounding funny to her. She didn't know why. She's like, oh. So I said, because I just ran off stage. I'm like, Mrs. Hooten, you got nothing to worry about. I got this. Right? I said, give me your number. I said, I'll call you back in like 5 minutes. So she gave me her number and went running out in the hallway. We had all these friends backstage that night. There was a bunch of our, like, we had a gang of people hanging out. There were like 20 of us. And they're like, Peyton Hooten, you know, he's like, we gotta find him. So I went to our head of John Langenstein. You guys remember John Langenstein? I said, Langenstein. I was like, we gotta find Peyton Hooten. And he's like, hold on. He got on the radio. There's only two banks of payphones in the whole Lakewood, right? So he just jumped on the radio to the other security guards. He said, is anybody talking on the payphone who looks like they might be lost? And they immediately identified this kid. They're like, there he is. So I was like, you gotta understand, it's still only been like 5-6 minutes since we walked off stage. I said, let's go. I'm like, John, let's go. We jumped on a golf cart. And we start going through the crowd. We're like driving through the crowd, me and Langenstein. It was like, high five, going through the crowd. Like, go to the payphones. The crowd is partying, and like we're high-fiving because everybody just was at the show together, you know. And it's like, hey man, like the tray, like. And then we're driving up, and here's this kid, like, you know, he's on the phone. He's on the phone. I see him. Now, you gotta say, he's never been to a concert. And he's like looking at the big screen, and I'm up there rocking on the guitar. And then, two minutes later, I'm riding out towards him in a golf cart. So he's standing there like this with his eyes really wide. And we went right up to him. And I jumped out and I said, Peyton Hooten, your mother is worried sick about you. You could just see it. Like, he said nothing. He was just like, I knew his name, but his mother was, the whole thing was, so we're like, come on. And we pulled him on the golf cart and we just started driving back. Still didn't say a word, not one word. Oh my God. And then we come around the corner, and I told you there's a gang of like 20 people were there, like all our friends, and they all knew I was doing this. So we come around the corner, and here's this gang of like older people than him. And we come around the corner, everybody goes, Peyton Hooten! They all like went, Peyton Hooten! They all like started hugging him and stuff. They're like, oh my God, you're okay. Everyone knew his name. So stupid. So then, very quickly, we just put him in this van. We're like, okay, Peyton Hooten. See you later, man. And his mom or something, somehow we had found out that he had lost his friends, and his friends were at some really sketchy gas station somewhere near Lakewood. And so the van driver, we said, just drop him off. Like, they went, and he dropped Peyton off across the parking lot from his friends. So there was no real visible evidence of him getting out of the van. He just, suddenly Peyton is back with his friends. Like, and I always like to imagine, like, what happened, like, you know, if he ran over, he's like, Trey just, I lost you guys, but Trey came out in a golf cart and he got me here. And they're like, all right then, yeah, right. I gotta tell you one addendum. I always have addendums to my, so then, like, I called Mrs. Hooten. I said, hey, Mrs. Hooten, everything's okay. It was cool. And then the next day, I called her again from the next band room phone. I was like, how's Peyton? She said, well, he's mowing the lawn. He's grounded. And she said in a very heavy Southern accent, she's like, I think he was on the pot. And I was like, well, okay, I'll go with that. He's on the pot. Anyway, what are we doing here? We're playing music, right? Okay. Okay. Thank you. So, I want to play this. This is, I don't even think this has a name yet, but it's very quiet and very, I mentioned this before, but I just need to talk about this because it's been just really, really like hard for me. But I did indeed lose a very dear friend last week who was kind of like a big part of our scene, you know. And this is my friend Chris Seacott, you know, from the Push Until the Day. Seacott is a friend of mine. Thank you. And the reason I say this is because we were, you know, best, just, I don't even know if there's a word for it, to have a friend that close, you know, a male friend that you like in, you know, one heart, two people. And from the age of 15, we went to our first concerts together. He was always there and, you know, represented a lot of, I don't know, he was like, you know, like we'd drive out to Colorado with Fish and I'd get there at 2 o'clock in the morning and, you know, I'd say, let's go skiing. And he'd be like, absolutely. And like, we'd walk up the mountain and ski, you know, like it was never, no, he never said no. Not only did he never say no, but there were countless times, I don't know, he sort of represented a sense of adventure or something to me. And when, you know, he had cancer and we sat on the couch and, just while he was drifting away, you know? And it was kind of like, you know, this whole, like, I can, like, turn anything into a positive. You know, oh, well, we had good times together, and, you know, and whatever that is, you know? And I just, it was hard this time for me to do that. Like, even, like, when he did finally sort of drift away, I was like, yeah, great. I'm grateful. I have gratitude, you know, all that good stuff about our times together, but like, I don't want this. You know what I mean? It's like, it wouldn't kind of pass that. And I know everybody out there has kind of felt that. So, you know, that it's like, and the same thing, it is my sister's birthday and I had that similar thing with her, but you know, so I was kind of playing the guitar while he was on the couch, this sad music. And but then it would kind of get happy and then it would kind of get sad. And this, I was looking for a word for it. There's a word, there's a Portuguese word called saudade, that there isn't really an English equivalent to it, but it's you know, sadness mixed, I think sort of sadness mixed with happiness, good times and bad times, but like a yearning for it not to be over, a recognition that there were good times, you know what I mean? With your loved one that isn't there anymore. So that's kind of what this is about. But I'm just going to play it. It's going to take a couple of minutes. It's kind of slow, but... And my friend Chris, I'm going to dedicate this to him. Thanks, you guys. I'll tell you one more quick story and then do the last song. But I'm only telling you this because... I'll just tell you this to finish off on my tribute to my pal there. But this is... There's two people standing over there, my wife and my manager. Is like, don't tell this story, please. They hate this story. They both made me, don't tell this story. So that's why I'm gonna tell it. It's not like it's horrible or anything, it's a nice story. But you know, like when I do this song, so. Every line in that song is basically a story, which I can tell a story about every single line in that song. But a lot of stuff's just these adventures and stuff that we had during this period, like sort of the late 90s, where everything was like so exciting. And I knew it. I knew that kind of couldn't last because it was so on the edge. And I wanted to write this song that captured the feeling of like, you know, staying up for three nights and all the time. So anyway, so that line, Pete threw a bomb and he rang the pole, was, I always, just this memory that I had that Fish was playing out in LA somewhere and we're like doing sound check. It was an outdoor show, maybe Ventura or something, I don't know, but it was like a big green field and beautiful outdoor venue, beautiful day. And we had this monitor mixer named Pete Shaw, And this guy, I tell you, as I stand here today, could throw a football like 60 yards. Like, the guy had an arm like a professional football player. And so it was one of my great joys was to watch this guy have play catch, like, with people, you know, because he could, you just, it was like a thing of beauty. It was like a piece of art. And we're up there playing sound check. There's no one in the venue. There's probably 7 or 8 people. And Pete went out and started, he got this local crew guy, and they started, They started tossing the ball. So Pete threw a bomb. So he went back, and we're all, you know, doing some weird fishing. And this guy goes back, and it's like, you know, 25-yard, perfect spiral. I'm like, oh. Yeah, and the guy was amazing. He's like, the local crew guy, he's running out. He's like, oh, yeah. Threw it back. And then Pete's like, longer, farther. It goes like 35 yards out, you know. Yeah, it goes whoosh, like ooh. I'm like, oh, look at that. And we're all kind of, we're like noodling. And then, you know, they kept going further. And then finally, I got to stand up because Pete's like, go long. It's a beautiful day. The grass is green. The sky is blue. We're in a band. We're on the road. We're young. It's like amazing. Everything was so great. It's just, it's like, this is what life is all about. It's kind of like, he throws the best bomb I've ever seen in my life. Whoosh! The thing's sailing through the air, perfect spiral, no wobble at all. I'm following this thing with my eyes, right? And then the guy's running like a gazelle. No, as a legs just flailing. The guy, like, the beautiful running, and the bomb's up in the air, and he puts his arms out. He's got his arms out to catch the football. He's running, and I'm looking. I'm like, oh, this is so beautiful. And right as the ball was about to go into his hands, I turned my head and I saw the telephone pole. It was so horrible. And I was like, oh, no. And we all kind of like went, ah, like, ah. And the guy had his hands like this, and he ran, like, with either hand on either side of the telephone pole. And the thing that I can't get out of my mind for the rest of it is the sound of the pole ringing. It was like, boom! I'm sorry, man. Sorry, guys. I told you, they kept on the head. Don't tell that story. But anyway. Okay. All right. Now you're never going to unsee that. Okay. All right, let me do one more song here. Then. I want to do this one because I like it. Hey, you guys, thank you so much for putting up with all this. Thank you. Really fun. Man, I gotta say, it's pretty cool to be standing right back in this spot. This spot was a very special, crazy little spot for in fish history. I don't know how many of you guys know about this, but is Sweet Pete here? Sweet Pete, you here? Anybody named Sweet Pete here? Okay, well, never mind then. Forget the whole story, because it's like, if Sweet Pete isn't here, I'm not telling it. Okay, so I'll tell it anyway. You guys can find Sweet Pete. So this is where, at the end of a really incredibly magical era that was one of the greatest periods of time in my life that I just hearken back to, ended. And a new era started, but it ended right in this spot. Because that's where we used to drive around the first touring that we ever did as a band. we had a, we bought this Plymouth Voyager. It was like a 19, this probably started sometime around 1988, which also happens to be the same year. It was the first time that we played that club. Yes, The Haunt. It was the first time we played The Haunt. And so we had this Plymouth Voyager. It was like this kind of beige Plymouth Voyager. And the four of us bought this thing, and we took the back seat out of it. So it was like two front seats, and then the whole back was like a bed, sort of like a futon or something. And my dog, Marley, my dog that I had, and the four of us, yay, thanks for cheering for, great dog. She was a great dog. Anyway, we drove around the country sometimes I look back at the routing, and we sometimes would do three loops in one tour around in this Plymouth Voyager, right? Two people driving and two people sleeping in the back. And this is the spot right here where Fish, when we eventually got rid of that car and we moved up to like a van and then ultimately to a bus, he handed the keys out at the end of the show. And Sweet Pete got the keys, okay? So Sweet Pete has the car, hopefully, and I want it back. So you tell Sweet Pete, I want that car back. Anyway, but it was a really nice era. Like, we had a really good time in those days, and I just remember like a lot of, we kind of like spoke our own language. We spent so much time together, the four of us, that we were kind of annoying to be around, because we would sort of talk in like jokes that were seven layers deep, you know? So you'd say Halifax and everybody would go, ah. And people like, you know, nobody really liked hanging around us that much, but it's because we spent so much time in that car. Anyway, what am I doing here? Playing music. I was waxing nostalgic. Thank you. It's good to be back. I just thought there's one other funny thing that happened here that I guess got to tell you while I tune this string up. We played at The Haunt, right? And the first couple times we played there, there must have been like three people. I think it was Mike's mom and like Fish's dad or something like that. Because, you know, he lived in Syracuse, so Fish's dad drove it. So, you like the way I'm talking with this annoying tuning thing going on? So, we'd play at The Haunt. We must have played there, I think, like 8 or 9 times. And every time we play there, we'd get a little more money. And the great breakthrough was the night that we played for The Door. Because I think we were getting like $250. We were so excited we were going to make this much money. And then right at the end of the night, we were loading out. And Mike, who can be a little, you know, his mind is other places. He was like carrying this box of cords or something like that. And they had this big glass door. And he was walking, and he like, with his nose, smashed into the door and broke the glass. So they told us it was $250 for the door. So we always think of that as the night we played for the door. And yes, the thing that one person yelled at when I was talking about driving in that car, it is true that Mike was never allowed to drive. I actually wasn't allowed to drive either, because Mike, I told this story once before, I gotta tell it again, it's too funny. Let me tell you why Mike wasn't allowed to drive, and then I swear I'll keep playing. So one day I'm driving up the highway, right, in Vermont. This is a true story. I'm driving up, 89 or whatever, going into Vermont, and this guy in front of me is going 45 miles an hour on the highway, really pissing me off. Like, 45 miles an hour on the highway. I'm like, ah, and I start going up, and I try to go around, and I pull up next to him, and it's Mike, right? And he's writing in his journal on the steering wheel. And I'm like, Mike! Anyway, that's why Mike wasn't allowed to drive. Fish and Paige drove. And me and Mike laid in the back. Why couldn't I drive? Because I talk too much. I'm not kidding. Because I'd be driving and I'd be telling a story. Like, you guys, you gotta hear this. It's really important. They were like, look at it. I don't know what I'm gonna play. I'm gonna think of this out. Do you guys remember Spin Magazine rated 300 fish songs? I don't know if you remember that. That's a couple of years ago. We don't really pay much attention to press, but when we heard that that 300 of our songs had been ranked from first to 300th, all four of us got very excited. We're like, we have to know about, you know. We immediately ran and got the magazine because we had to find out what our most medium song was. We didn't really care about the best or the worst. So we like went, we went straight to the magazine and went to number 150, right? So that we would always know from that point on what our most medium song was. I don't know how this is going to work on the acoustic guitar, but I will now play for you our most medium song. Now, for the record, we disagree with Spin Magazine. We like this song. But anyway, this is it. I gotta play this. I'd like to play this now for Sue, for my wife, my beautiful wife, my friend. Because I'm thinking about this is from that era when we used that I've been talking about. So, what day is it? It's February 9th, yeah. In 6 days, we'll have the anniversary of our first date 29 years ago, Sue and I. Which is pretty mind-blowing to me. I took her to Nectar's, that's true. I was like, where do you want to go anyway? How about Nectar's? That's true. Oh my God. Oh, it worked. Man, okay. I guess if you can do that on an acoustic guitar. Let me try this. You guys are in the forgiving mood right now. I love this song. This is one of my favorite fish songs. So I'm gonna try this. This is not built for an acoustic guitar, but let's see what happens. I'm giving it a whack. The old college try. Okay, ready. It is so nice to be here. What a room. My sister came here, went to Harvard, and she was at Winthrop House. Anybody from Winthrop House? Shout out to my sister's house. I don't even know where it is. I just know she is. I know she was there. I did visit her once. Let me do this song. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm kind of playing this by ear, but incredible machines that make Legos. They have like rubber, it's how it's made, right? But rubber tubes with color, like it looks sort of like Willy Wonka with this like color things going down these tubes and machines turning them into little cubes with the Legos are all flying out. There's no humans at all until the last stage. If you ever watch that, that how it's made. In the last stage, all the Legos go into this big box and all the humans have to do is just pour one box into the other box. These like incredible intricate computers. And then you see these guys and they get the box and then they go and like half of them spill on the ground after this amazing journey that the Legos have made to perfection with computers. Anyway. I'm also a big fan of whoever writes the music for that show. Deserves a shout out. And I mean that. Man, one time I used to live with Paul Langerdoc. He used to run Sound for Fish. You guys know him. But Paul built my guitar, and I don't know why this, I'm thinking about this right now. Something clicked in my mind. But and Fish, John Fishman, and I and Paul were roommates in the '80s. We used to. It's kind of like when Fish had just first started. We were working locally around Burlington. I used to work at a pet food warehouse. Carrying the 50-pound bags. And Fish was a ticket taker at a parking garage. So I don't know, it's goodbye. And I don't know if any of you guys are Facebook friends with Fish, but if you are, you know that he gets very obsessed with, like I like telling stories about Fish. I'm a big guy. But, like, he gets into something and he really gets into it. And so, what just popped into my mind was that when we were roommates back then, he started wanting to eat healthier and he discovered wheatgrass, right? So he started by taking a shot of wheatgrass down at the health food store. And then he read somewhere, because this is kind of his pattern. He's kind of obsessed with things. That the wheatgrass would be better if you grew it at your own house. So he got these like 50-gallon tubs of dirt, and our house was filthy. It was like three guys living together, you know, nobody ever cleaned anything. So he got this special dirt that was flown in from, you know, wherever, the hills of Thailand or something, these wheatgrass seeds, and he kept getting more and more obsessed with it. The next thing you know, our kitchen had this wheatgrass grinder. All he ever talked about was wheatgrass. Like, just wheatgrass, wheatgrass, wheatgrass. So anyway, one day, I come home, and I walk in the front door. This is a completely true story. And he had made some decision that it wasn't working well enough by drinking the wheatgrass. And I walked in the front door, and I opened the door, and Fish was lying on his back with, like, his butt to the door, giving himself a wheatgrass enema. he had a big rubber syringe in one hand and a white towel, and there was like green juice all over the white towel. Anyway, I'm never gonna unsee that. You're never gonna unsee it. So all these friends that are here tonight, I just want to say this, so I will. It's my friend Chris Leeds in the audience, and my friend Sean, you see me, and my friend Molly, I think, my friend Kevin, and we all had a very dear mutual friend, my friend Seacott, who's the hero of the Push On Till the Day song, and thanks so much. So, this guy is a guy that I truly loved so much. And we lost him a couple weeks ago to cancer, very sadly. And I sat out there with him. You know, this guy's a friend since 15 years old. I sat with him on the couch for the last week that he was with us and just played the guitar and very quietly. And he was kind of breathing, and he would kind of, it's amazing that I'm talking about this. My friend Sean, who's in the audience, was there with me. And he would sort of breathe, he was kind of like sleeping for like many, many hours, and I'd just play real quietly, you know? And then I would stop, and he would kind of open his eyes, and I'd say, "Hey, man." And I'd look at him and be like, "Hey, how you doing?" And so I started writing this thing that I'm gonna play now. And it's sad, you know, but it kind of goes between sad and memories of all these good times we had together, because there were a lot of them. A lot of good times. And so I'm gonna dedicate this to everybody in the audience who's thinking, "Yeah, I just went through that too," because it's probably pretty much just about everybody in here, the way things go, and so we all feel this. I didn't know what to call this, so I'm just going to call it "Till We Meet Again" or something like that, because that's what I hope. I'm going to hope that. What happens in this room normally? Is there concerts here? How many of you actually go to Harvard? None? Not one? It's crazy. It's so crazy. Could you tell us you guys aren't so smart? You're not so smart. It's just regular, like me. Okay. I'm gonna tone down the intellectual garble then. How to impress a few people. I don't know, I can talk about normal stuff. Like the incredible fact that if you touch your phone in the right place, a pizza arrives at your door. Just love that. Pizza. Like regular stuff. Like that, I can talk. It's amazing playing to this in this atmosphere. It's making me want.
We love you, Trey.
Oh, thank you. That's a nicer thing to yell at them, you know, like, "Stop playing bullshit. It's all that weird stuff you're doing. What are you, some jam guy?" Jennifer dances? Oh, man. Okay, I don't know that song. Thank you. Man, that chord, that song has so many chords in it. My God! 1,000 chords in that song. Normally, I just like page play them. I just kind of... Chicken, chicken. the wild wild kind of guy, you know. Decided that, by the way, that Wild Wild Petals were sexy. I mean, just for like a couple of years there in the 70s. Man, that's just the thing. I started high school in the 70s. That shows you how old I am. But I did. I started high school in the 70s. I just remember going to like high school dances, and you'd go, every band. This is like when I wanted to be in a band. Every band looked like 1978 Leonard Skinner. Like they all had long hair, like the guitars and the like flying V guitars and huge gear. So like I can remember going to, you know, my middle school dance with Susanna Goodman, my date. You know, like real awkward, we're like 14 years old, you know. Nobody's on the dance floor, and it's like in the gym and there's chaperones and people's moms and stuff. And like, you know, one couple is like out there and boys, like, got his arm like a foot from, and like up on the stage is this band, like with hair down to here, you know, like, huge amplifiers and all this stuff. It was amazing time to grow up. It made me want to be a man. I don't know. I should be playing music, but I just gotta tell you one more thing, and then I'll stop talking, I swear. Yeah, I remember going over, having this moment where I went over to my friend Eric's house, Eric Jensen. He had two older brothers, and I was like in eighth grade or something like that. And we went over to his house. It must have been, well, how old are you in eighth grade? Like 13 or something? 14. So I was born in 78. It was 1978. And these guys had a motorcycle and like a garage. And so me and Eric went over, and his brothers were like long hair, and you know, they were, you know, 18 or 20 years old or something like that. They had this motorcycle on blocks, and they were drinking tall boy cans and smoking like dirt weed and revving the motor of the motorcycle. Let me try some beer and like some, you know, some pot. And then the guy put on Mississippi Queen. I was like, I want to do that. That's what I want to do. Greatest day ever. Life changing. Anyway, I'm not talking anymore. Parking garage, right? And oh man, I say this story with such shame. top, and I was having a good time, and, well, thank you. Let's knock it over again and see if it comes back. Faking early onset dementia. Sorry. I did think about it though, because you know, you can kind of, you know, do whatever you want. I forgot the bathroom is. Oh, sorry. Oh, please. Oh, God. Social media terror. Social media terror. Now I'm going to get a letter from early onset dementia people. What was I talking about? Roleplay. Okay, I gotta play some songs. Hey, look, let me just finish this story where I'll play five songs after this. So I always think about this when I come to Pittsburgh, because I went up in this parking garage, went to the top, had my rollerblades on, and I started coming down, and there's a security guard there in his security guard outfit, and he came running out. I was about on, like, say, the sixth floor with six to go, and he said, "You can't rollerblade here." And I was like, okay, that's cool. Like, be really super nice, you know. And I said, I won't rollerblade. I'm just gonna zip down and go out, right? And he said, no, you can't rollerblade here. There was no cars, by the way. It's just empty. It was like a Western movie. It was like the two of us. And he said, right downtown. You guys go by it every day. And he said, no, you gotta take off your rollerblades and walk on your socks and walk down the stairs. And I'm like, I'm not gonna do that. I just, you know, sir, I'm sorry. I'm trying to be nice and everything, but if you don't mind, I'll just very quietly, I'll just whoop, zip out the door. You'll never see me again. And he was like, nope. And he's kind of looking at me, and I was looking at him, and then I just like went around him. And I started going down, right? So I'm like going down. I got about like two floors, and I was on the fourth floor, and all of a sudden this guy runs out of the stairs, and he's like standing there. Like, oh my God. And so I'm like going, and I whip by him again. Going down, I get down, wonderfully runs down, and he's like there again, trying to block me. Now we're on, like, say, the third floor or something. And he got me. I went by and he grabbed me. And then we were holding each other, and then all of a sudden, we were fighting. Like an actual fight. Which, I mean, I haven't been in a fight. We were like fighting the way two people who don't actually fight, you know, you're like, what? Hitting each other. This, by the way, this really happened. I'm not making any of this up. I felt horrible. Like, I can't believe I'm in a fight in the 90s. You know? Yeah, that's cool. So anyway, and I was grabbing at his hair. He had product, I remember his hair. Grabbed his hand and his product, and we were pulling. And then what happened was, somehow my hand got on. It was like he had like a walkie-talkie or something, and I got it, and then I threw it as like a defensive. We had like we were grappling, and I threw it, and it went bash, and it like smashed into pieces. And then I felt so bad. Like, I had the worst feeling that maybe this guy was going to have to pay for this thing. And when it smashed, he kind of turned around to look at his walkie-talkie thing. And then I just whoops out the door. So the worst part of the story is that I swear to you, for the next like 5 years, I felt so bad about this. And every time we come to Pittsburgh, the first thing I do is go to this parking garage and look for this guy so that I can, like, buy him a new walkie-talkie or something, or, like, apologize for... I've never found him, but I have him back. So, if you see a guy, if you happen to be walking around, and you're like, oh, I just went and saw that guy from Fish, and, you know, asshole. You say, do you work in a parking garage? And then tell me, and I'll buy him a new walkie-talkie. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me see. somebody's yelled for that song. That's another one. I can take a whack at it. Because the best thing about it is the harmony. But sometime, when, probably like in the early or mid 80s or sometime, Mike and I went to the Flint Theater in Burlington and we saw we saw a concert called the Masters of the Folk Violin, and it's a really cool concert with all these American folk violinists. And the last person to come out as the kind of finale was a 90-year-old jazz violinist and a, I think, 16 or 17-year-old young girl who is a longbow fiddle champion named Allison Krauss. And we'd never heard of her. Nobody had. She hadn't been signed. She didn't really have a career. Yet. And she came out and she played some amazing fiddle, and then all of a sudden at one point she opened her mouth and started to sing, and Mike and I both, we were in the back there, I remember we both just like fell on the ground at the same time, like, oh my god. And we became very obsessed and kind of saw her play many times in the 80s. We'd go see her, and one time we were out in LA recording the album that ultimately was called Hoist for All Things. That's a whole other story, by the way. But I'm not gonna wait for you. But she was playing at the Troubadour, still unsigned with Union Station, and we went to the show, and then we waited by the stage door, and she came out. We're just like, hi, I'm Trey, and this is Mike, and we said we're in a band, and we'd like you to sing on our album. She, of course, never heard of us or anything, and she said yes, which was so bizarre. So, she must have been still like in her 20s, to get early 20s. She had not been signed to a label yet, unsigned act. Her band got in the bus and went to San Francisco from LA, and me and Mike picked her up at the hotel the next morning. And it was during the California fires were happening, and we had to sneak around a bunch of blocked off roads and stuff. The studio was being threatened by the fire, and people thought it might burn down. Anyway, our producer thought we were nuts. You know, who is this? You know, can she sing? I'm like, yeah, she can sing. And so we brought her in, and she went in there, and I played her the song. She liked the song, and I don't know if you guys have ever heard that version with her singing on it, of this, but it's so. We were all in the control room, and she opened up her mouth, and I did the chorus, you know. Take me if I could. And she went, and everybody's just melting in the control room. I remember, and then last thing, and then she finished that first take, and we were just like, oh my god, that was the best thing I've ever heard. And she went, that sucked. I'm like, it did? She said, yeah, I can do better than that. And she did. So anyway, this is dedicated to Allison. She's not here tonight, but I want you guys to imagine her singing, or sing along and like her or something. It's funny playing that Harry Hood on the acoustic guitar was actually written on the acoustic guitar when I was 19. Fish and I, when we were buskers in Europe. We played street music in Europe. We met when we were 18, the two of us, up in Vermont, and hit it off, you know, immediately. And we came up with this, cooked up this idea to go play street music, and we painted houses in New Jersey for... was that woo for painting houses or for New Jersey? It's like, house painting is all right. It's not that great. It's hot. It always takes so much longer than you thought it was going to take. You make an estimate, you know? This, anyway. So, but we saved some money and we went over there and we, the two of us lived, the cheapest way we could do it was we rented a car, a Ford Fiesta, a little Ford Fiesta, and we slept in the car for the whole summer, every night, never in a bed, and we played street music in front of the Pompidou in Paris and in Munich and in Italy, and eventually we ended up in Greece, and we lived on this, we went to Corfu, this island off Greece, and we slept on the beach for 3 weeks, and that's where I wrote that song, Harry Hood, on the acoustic guitar. So it kind of sits on the acoustic guitar a little. But that was really fun. He's just a fun guy to do that with because he talks a lot. It's a really, really nice summer. Thanks, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. I'm having such a good time. And thinking like, you know, if you're an animal, like a wildebeest or something like that, you might get eaten today. Since we're human, we're probably not gonna get eaten. Can you tell I just watched Planet Earth too? I did. They just keep eating each other. Every scene, you know what I mean? Like, it's beautiful. And then there's the beautiful bird, and then crocodile, slow motion, full orchestra. Beautiful baby wildebeest walks to the edge. Its parents tell it, don't walk to the edge, but they don't listen. They walk to the edge, they're by the water, and then the crocodile comes, and I do hope that if I get eaten, it happens in fast motion. But I'll take the orchestra. Okay.
Jets fan, but as Jet fans, since we have no hope, it's hopeless, we basically only kind of want one thing, which is for the Patriots to lose, so. We love you, we're all Eagles fans today. That was great, that was incredible. Okay, alright, let's get back to the warm response. No, I just was remembering that one time Fish played in Lille, France, and we were on this bill with, we used to tour with Santana, so Santana was the headliner, and we were in the middle, and there was this amazing, amazing Israeli singer named Noah. Have you ever heard of her? She doesn't come to the States because she doesn't like to travel, but she's absolutely stunning, beautiful singer, beautiful. She went on before us. And it was the concert was kind of running later and later and later. People wanted to see Santana. It was sold out. Big, like, mini kind of half amphitheater, stone, ancient arena thing. And I had a bad feeling, man, when we went on stage. I had a bad feeling. It was, I couldn't shake it all night because I don't think about what we're going to play. I just walk on and start making up songs. I didn't know what to play. We walked out there on stage and we went to play the first note. And we got booed off stage. And let me tell you something, that is something you only want to have happen once in your life. But the way they boo over there is that they whistle. And they whistle loud. And they really know how to whistle, like, you know. And so the whole audience, we kind of started the first song, we're kind of like, and there's like, and then, oh my God, deafening whistling. Because they wanted to see Santana. And, the funniest part about this story was that the three of us, me and Fish and Paige, were kind of looking at each other like, oh my God, what's going on? But Mike didn't know that whistling meant boo. So he was like, and one moment I walked over, I said, Mike, whistling means boo. Like, he's like, oh, okay. So anyway, let me play some music here. So thanks. Hey, man. This song in years, partially because I wrote this. This is ostensibly a breakup song, though it's actually from a friend. And I write breakup songs. So I don't know if I've ever played this. Maybe like once, but I do want to play it today. And I'd like to report that everything went back to normal with this person, but it didn't. So, for like 20 years, I never talked to them. Oh, maybe this one's got so similar chords, but different words. I'll play it because it's so easy to remember since I just played these chords. I should dedicate this one to two of the coolest women on earth. You know who I'm talking about. Abby Jacobson and Lana Glaser. I put them at like fifth or sixth, which is pretty good because my wife Sue is number one. Sorry, Abby. And my daughters, Eliza and Bella, are number two and three. Anyway, here we go. Cher. Cher? I think she's right. Michelle Obama? Politics. Politics and Fish. That doesn't work. We love everyone. Everyone is welcome. I still think Michelle Obama's cool. I can think she's cool without getting political. Right? I think she's cool. Oh, my mom. Sorry, Michelle. Forget Michelle. You're off the list. Cher. I still think Cher is cool. What about Kristen Shaw? You guys like her? Mel, you know, from Flight of the Conchords? The greatest groupie of all time? She's cool. I want a groupie like that, so. If any of you can, like, rise to the occasion of groupiedom, like Mel, and just meet me by the bus after the show. It's on, man! So am I gonna put Kristen at, like, after my mom? Before Michelle and Cher. This is so complicated. It's amazing that, I just gotta say this because it's on my mind. You guys are mine, right? Even like one drop of politics in this world just made me sick to my stomach. I really couldn't give a fuck. Yeah. Seriously. Just saying. Our quasi-political drummer tried to get me and Paige in on that, and I was just like, no, 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 no. Jeez. I love him to death. He's my favorite guy, but. Stupid things and then you have to live with them for the rest of your life. Not you. Not that guy. That guy's never done anything stupid. Once. Yeah. No, and I was like, I grew up in New Jersey, you know? Jersey Straw. And just like on a block, you know? Which was really fun. I mean, I lived it like on a, you know, on a block. And I think back about that. We used to, everybody used to run out on the block and nobody had cell phones or anything like that. It was kind of, I feel like such an old guy. But it really was nice. But in Jersey, you can get a moped license when you're 15. You know, and so like, I was telling my parents when I was 13, I was like, I want a moped. My mom didn't want me to have one because she knew I would crash and jump it and do all this stuff. She said, if you earn the money yourself, you can get it. So I got all these summer jobs and stuff, saving the money. And I got this moped. A Pook Maxi Lux. Anybody here ever have a moped? Do they still have mopeds? They have mopeds? I don't see them much. Do kids get mopeds when they're 15 or... Oh, okay. I don't know. I felt like I was like in the Wild Ones or something. Smoking a cigarette, riding my moped. I really did that. With my glasses, my cigarette, my moped. Watch out. Hey, ladies, here I come. Oh, my God. I attached a tape deck, a cassette deck, to the back. And I had these big headphones, and I had a cassette that was duct taped in, so it had to keep playing. It was Whiter Shade of Pale by Procol Harum. Purple. I'd get on and light my cigarette. We skip the lights, then dango. Riding on my... Oh, God. So anyway, so here's the thing I felt bad about. So one day I gave this guy a ride. I think it was Phil DiMonati. I hope, Phil, if you're out there and you heard this, it might not have been you. I can't remember who it was. Sorry for invoking the name of an actual human who's gonna... Social media is just the worst thing, man. I'm sorry. You say one thing and it's like, boom! Everybody hears. God. Anyway, his name was Don Smith, okay? I made that up. Now I don't have to get an email from somebody. Anyway, I'm like, I got this guy in my movement. And I was always screwing around because it's just the way it was. And we got on this hill and we're like ripping down this hill. Like, you know, going fast, you know, those things don't go that fast, but you can get going pretty good on a hill. And I'm like ripping down this hill. And this guy's on the back of my moped. And I'm like taking my hands off. Like, and then I started going like, I was like, oh my God! The brakes don't work! And this guy jumped off. Because he thought we were going to crash. But I was just joking. He jumped off, and it was bad. He, like, tumbled out his, you know, blood. And anyway, we were going home in the bandages and apologizing, like, profusely over and over. He was just... wasn't accepting it. I still feel bad about that. Thank you. Where are we going with this? God, thank you for listening to that. Getting that off my chest. It's been carrying around that moped thing. And I always want to stop, you know, fish contest, I always want to stop the jam and get that off my chest. Fish just keeps playing back there. I'm like, stop, I gotta tell the moped story. Dude, stop playing so many. All right, let me play some songs now. Thanks, you guys, you're so patient. Okay, let me do stuff I wanna do here. I get to. That's the advantage of having the guitar in your hand. Oh, can I get the D guitar, please? Can I get D guitar? Get me, get D guitar.
Man, thank you for being here. I wasn't sure if I should play that or not, because I love playing it here. It's beautiful, and when Mike taught us, he taught us what the meaning of the words were and everything, so we wouldn't just be singing them, which is very nice. But Paige and I, you know, I'm Catholic, so I spend most of my time wondering if the body of Christ is gluten-free. I'm messing it up now. Anyway. Oh, thank you. Happy Valentine's. John Fishman, my beautiful friend who I love so much. He was best man at my wedding, and Sue was here. Happy Valentine's Day, Sue. When Fish was the best man at my wedding. It was a great wedding. He was a very good best man. He was the best man. Everybody says that. But no, he looked like an ape man, like when I first met him. He had like hair out to here, like a big beard, and like, you know, a huge shirt. And I'll never forget it. The first second I met him, it was just so funny. And we were playing music within seconds. It also, I just got to tell you this one quick story. One of, it was reminding me when I was just playing that song. Did you guys ever see, there's a photo from sometime in the 90s of the band where we were dressed as cavemen. Has anybody ever seen that? It's kind of like a quasi, it's around, you can find it if you Google it, but we had done this photo shoot, right? Where, I think it might have been with the guy who did all those very laid out Rolling Stone covers, and so they had props, we showed up for this photo shoot, and they had like props and costumes and all this stuff. Like, we're gonna make you guys into cavemen. You know, we were all kind of quasi-reluctant, but like, whatever you need to do, you know? It's like, you know, I don't know, something about the style of music, but we reminded them of cavemen. So they brought, like, these really elaborate props. And so they put hair on the back of our arms, and, you know, like, hair extensions, and like, these animal skin suits, and, like, spears, and I think one guy had like a fish that he had just caught, or like, you know, bloody clubs and stuff. So they set up, and these photo shoots, they take a really long time, like the whole day. They set up and they're changing the lights and everything. We're all standing there like, kind of like. And then Mike said, you know, you kind of whispered about me and Fish were sort of standing here. And Mike said, you know, Neanderthal man, you know, it's been proven by science that Neanderthal man had a much easier life than modern man. And that actually all they ever did was lay around and like groom each other and roll around in a pile and eat food. And you know, we have this horrible 40-hour work week, and it's just the worst that humanity has ever been. And Fish and I kind of started getting in this argument with him. We're like, okay, what are you talking about? And like, you know, I'll take a house, you know, and there's saber-toothed tigers and all this stuff. But the funny thing about this was that it turned into this as bad a band argument as we've ever had. Like, we were getting so mad, and he wouldn't back down. Like, Mike, you're being so stupid. And then he'd say, concentrate, and we'd like, go for it. And it's getting worse and worse, and Paige is kind of over there trying to mediate between me and Fish and Mike. He wouldn't back down. It's just the stupidest thing I've ever heard in my life. Fish is like, how could you say that? It's like raining, and there's, you know, like, whatever those things with elephants with other guys with spears, and, oh, God. Fish was getting so mad. Anyway, it dawned on me somewhere in the middle of that we were arguing about cavemen.
dressed as cavemen. And what this must have looked like. But we were so mad, there was no laughing. Anyway, if you ever look at that photo, you'll see it, but the funny thing about it is that, I mean, I thought it was going to be the end of the band, right? But I was so pissed, and I went to the library right from the photo shoot just to prove Mike wrong. And he was right. He was completely right. Apparently our lives suck, but really suck. And they did just lay around, and I think they hunted once a month. The rest of the time they just laid around. So think about that next time. Okay. Okay, let me get some songs. I think I'm gonna send this as my Valentine's Day song, because I wrote this song sitting, I'll never forget it. I was sitting on the floor next to the bed. Well, I'd say it was probably sometime around August 20th of 1995. How do I know that? Because Sue was nine months pregnant with our first baby, Eliza, who's 22 years old now. And I had this little book of, I used to have this thing, it's called The Salamander Prince. It was a book of ramblings that Tom had sent me. And my general songwriting process at that time was, like, I would take a couple of lines out of that, and then I would add a couple of lines and kind of make these songs. But anyway, this one was written probably about a day before I became a father. So, send this to Sue for my Valentine's Day. Man, I'm like sitting here in this beautiful, you know, I'm thinking about Mike, and I'm thinking about all the time he spent, telling me he spent at Hebrew school and when he was growing up. And I suddenly remembered that, I kept doing this Catholic thing, and I feel like I'm supposed to confess things. Is that part of it? Is it just a Catholic thing, the guilt? Or is it? Does everybody have that? Everybody has the guilt? No, this is such a stupid, this isn't even a funny story, but I had this memory of Mike and I burgled together when we were young. We burgled. And it's just such a funny thing to imagine, to picture in my mind, but luckily it didn't work. We had a truck when, we had this box truck when we first started out that we used to load our gear into. We didn't have any crew guys. And it was just the four of us in this heavy gear. And Mike and I thought we needed a ramp. And we didn't have a ramp, and we couldn't afford a ramp. So one day we tried to go burgle a ramp. Which is so ridiculous. I'm saying this in the eyes of God. I tried to burgle. 100 we burgled. So being Mike and I, we were dressed in like burglar clothes. like a ski mask with eyes. And I put like some black makeup on. Or played the, Pink Panther theme. And then we went down to U-Haul. This is a true story. And we snuck around and we went and we got this ramp and pulled it out. From the, the U-Haul truck. You start like running, and like, poof, and they're locked. Apparently, people burgle the U-Haul ramps like on a regular basis because they locked it. So we didn't get away with it, but we burgled in our heart. Heart burgle. The heart burgle. Who said that? That's good. I'm going to say this, and I hope I'm not going to hurt much feelings. Paige made fish cry one time. He doesn't mind. Paige, you don't mind. I don't know. Because even like everything you say now goes on social media. I'll tell him that I told the story. Fish used to be late for everything. Like really late. On a regular basis. When we were starting off as a band, and we used to rehearse in our, we rehearsed in my, me and Fish lived together with Paul and I, and we rehearsed in our living room. And he would like, by the way, he's not anymore. He's reformed his ways, but the three of us would go in there and like, he said, oh, your band practice at 11 o'clock, and then like 11:15, the three of us would go in and like, sit there at things, and it'd be like, you know, 11:30, 11, and Fish's room was right down the hall, so he'd be like, writing his journal, like calling a girl, like, or something, and he'd just sitting there, and Paige would just get madder and madder and madder and madder, steaming mad, like really mad, and just, and finally Fish came in this one time, and that's it. That's the whole story. Sorry. There was more. There's nothing more than that. That's it. You guys want so much. That's not enough. I'm getting ready. T-shirt, make Trey shut up. Does this guy ever shut up? Okay. Oh, let me, can I have this, please? I want to sing this song. Thank you. Let's see.
Trey and Shul.
What was it?
Trey and Shul.
Oh. So much. Funnily enough, as funny as this may sound, this feels sort of like a hometown gig for me. my sister lived in Carrboro. Unfortunately, she has moved on in life. We lost her a few years ago, but my nephew's here tonight, my amazing nephew Jason. Jason goes to friend school. Has no friend school. Anyway, so I spent a lot of time down here and I love it. So thank you for helping me. Let me see. Let me do this because it's so fun. For me, at least. You know the Wallace Wayne Stadium? Yeah. Duke University. It's like close to here, right? Yeah. I warmed up for the Stones. Yeah. That was an incredible experience. I gotta tell you. Just remember that that's right next, we're close to there. Yeah, it's 2005. You guys remember 2005? I'm not much memory of 2005. But I did warm up for the Stones. It's funny, man. Like, warming up for the Stones is sort of like meeting Mickey Mouse or something. Like, you go behind the curtain and you see all this stuff that you never thought you'd see. It's not what you think. You guys are probably thinking one thing, but it wasn't that, it was a whole different thing. But it was, I guess I don't want to give away all their secrets and everything. But, you know, you kind of go back and there's like makeup chairs and stuff. And, you know, Keith's like getting his. And they've got, one of the things that really, like, seriously impressed me. Blew my mind actually was that they have three full-time these three women that are there, they have boxes of clothes that like every designer on the planet has sent all these free clothes, hoping that the Stones will wear them, because I'm guessing if Mick Jagger walks out on stage with his shirt on or something, you know, it gets on a magazine. But I just didn't quite expect that. I mean, there's like thousands, like boxes and boxes of clothes, and these women kind of lay out their clothes for the night based on what the costume changes are going to be and everything. And they're doing them. And I mean, I could go on and on, but the funniest part for me, I mean, it was so exciting. I mean, I was thrilled. Like the guitar tech took me up on stage and he said, Do you want to touch the Telecaster from Exile on Main Street? And I was like, yes, I do. Sure. He took me back and I touched the guitar that, you know, like invented everything I care about. Other than, you know, my family. But you know, you know, like I did, you know, all this kind of stuff. And then they had this like room that's sort of like a cool room with a pool table, like a cool hangout room. And the warm-up band, you know, you go in there and they put you in front of the pool table, like where, you know, you feel cool because it's a pool table. Pool tables are cool, I guess. And then there's this like pipe and drape. So there's like a sheet, just a sheet hanging. And you hear on the other side of the sheet, you hear like the Stones kind of gathering, right? Jennifer was with me, I think he might have added one more name to the, you know, he's Trey, he's the bad guy, it's his name. And that's Jennifer, or whatever. And then, interestingly, their backup singer, Lisa Fisher, had sung on my album. She sang on Night Speaks to a Woman and Money, Love, and Change. So we knew each other. She's the, oh, Night Speaks! That's Lisa Fisher from the Rolling Stones. But she does so many sessions that, of course, she didn't remember that either. So they're like, who sang on his album? I can hear all this. And then, you know, they like, so they have all the stuff on, the ladies are giving the clothes, they put the makeup on, like, and they're like in full Rolling Stones regalia. And we're standing by the pool table, and the photographer is like, stand here. And we're standing here like this. And then they open the curtain, right? And the Rolling Stones, en masse, the whole band, you know, as the Rolling Stones in full Rolling Stones regalia with like the drink and the cigarette and everything, come through the door. And they're like, Trey! I'm like, that's funny. That's so funny. And Keith came over and put his hands on my face. He's like, Trey, how you doing? You're thinking about me a lot, you know, you miss me. And then they like turn around and they get the picture, and then whoop, you're gone. It was perfect. It was like, that's the thing. Don't get me wrong. It's exactly what I wanted. I lost a very dear friend of mine a couple weeks ago, and it's like my oldest friend, it's Chris, my oldest friend Chris, and from very young. And you know, I know I'm only sharing this because I know everybody can hope. I mean, I'm guessing that everybody can relate to these feelings, so I'm just kind of sharing this feeling that you know. Upbeat, positive person, but it's almost like I don't know, I want to play this song. I wrote this song, I sat with him on his last, first last 3 days or so, and he just was breathing, and then he drifted off, and I was playing the guitar next to him, so this is kind of what I was playing. It kind of goes back and forth between being, it's sort of like happy times, and it's sad. It's like good memories, you know, when you have a friend or someone dear like that, and then, you know, and then the sadness, so somewhere in between. And I didn't know what to call it. I ended up calling it, I'm calling it Till We Meet Again, because that's what I want. So thank you. Names. When I come walking back, what, you know, a little bit down here. You're listening to Trey of the House of Fish. Of the blood of the ocelot. Third of his name. The completely burnt. King of Prussia. The divider of skies. The family berserker. Jasmine of the Velvet Sea. Protector of the book. Tramper of lambs and pecker of doves. Yanker of tunics and dangler of stash. King of the anvils, the riders, and the first tube. Melter of faces. And father of lizards. Like, we always look at each other, you know, and he's like, got the funny smile. He loves this song. You know, just for the record, I gotta play this song. It's really fun being in a band. It's a crazy thing. Because, like, we used to spend so much time, we still do. We just spend so much time together. It's really, like, it's, I don't know, it's an amazing thing, man. Like, I think I was looking back at the 1994 tour. We went like 100. It was a good year, but part of the reason was because we looped the country 3 times. As far as, I'm not kidding, in a car. You know, we drove in a car together. We didn't have a bus or anything like that. We drove, and we went, you know, we drive long drives from, like, I remember playing in, like Seattle, and the next gig would be like Madison, Wisconsin. And you would just go. And, you know, you talk, you know, you start speaking like in a language that no one else can understand. And, like, you know, you can say one thing and it refers to like 6 levels of joke that are way down. And it's just cool. And, you know, I love those guys so much. All three of them. You know, the smartest, funniest people that I've ever met. And I can't believe, said this into a microphone before, but I do on a regular basis think I cannot believe that I ended up with the three of them. Like, it's the weirdest thing. We really had a good time together. Still, I mean, you probably think I'm talking about the fact that broccoli rabe is actually a vegetable, not a dish. Did you know that? Did you know that? I'm serious. Did you know that? You knew that? I didn't know that. That's not interesting. That's not the contrast. Oh, the contrast is was that I got here last night. I teleported here. I'm sick of the bus. So I was standing outside the gig and I looked up and I thought I saw this weird space vehicle. Forgot. It was like this huge party going on. Is it always like that on Friday night? No, serious. The whole spaceship thing is over now. Now I'm being serious. I'm deadly serious. There was like music and pumping and people on the street. It was like Mardi Gras or something. Right? I was right downtown. This happens on Friday night. Is this correct? Because man, it was like mayhem, sirens going and people fighting and stuff. It's like 1:30 in the morning. Is it even more 2 o'clock? No, it's crazy. I forgot. This town is kind of wild. And then the contrast was when I walked in here, it's a beautiful and pin drop quiet audience. Probably because you have to live with, you know, that. And you can be like, oh my god, it's supposed to be quiet. I need to see a concert. I need to find some place where it's quiet. It's funny because a few years ago I would have gone out and joined the party. I'd have been like, yeah, 1:30, just waking up. Everybody's out. But I didn't do that last night. We used to stay up pretty late. Oh. I can tell you a funny story about that. I'm going back to songs. I'll just tell Fearoff very quickly. One time we were, in 2003, we were in Cincinnati, right? Were you there? See one of you. So at that point in time, we were definitely on the, all four of us and our, all of our 8 zillion friends that were traveling around with us were definitely on the late schedule. We were staying up late Wednesdays. Particularly me and Paige, funnily enough. Sorry, Paige, he doesn't like me. Just like to read books and stuff. He's gonna be mad at me. Anyway, and we were in this hotel in Cincinnati. I don't know if we had the gig the next day or the gig the next day. And we used to carry, like, I used to carry duct tape and stuff, black duct tape to tape the curtains because I would always get to bed at like 11 o'clock in the morning and the sun, and Paige had the stuff too. And so we were up, we were hanging out with some friends, and I remember Paige was down in his room, and he had some friends over in his room, and I had some friends in my room, and I was, every once in a while I would sit down to the hall and like go in there, how you doing in here? Everything good? And so it's like, I don't know, 9 o'clock in the morning or something, I'm thinking, okay, I gotta go to bed, I gotta get, you know, I gotta go to bed. I'm standing there, and you know, all the real, like, you know, dregs of the night, of course, in my room. And and I'm standing there, looking out the window, I was like on the like 14th floor, 20th, high up. And all of a sudden I start to hear these sirens, right? And it's like sirens everywhere. Woo, woo, woo. Like, damn, I'm like, I know this is me. Like, whatever it is, I know it's my fault. This is, I started thinking about this last night when I called into town because of all the sirens, and I was like, no, I'm like, it's not me. It's gotta be me. Whatever they're mad about, or, you know, I'm sure it's my fault. But so I'm standing there, and I'm looking out the window, and there's like all of a sudden, cop cars and like that, and then fire trucks and more fire trucks, and I'm looking down, and then they park, and then they start extending the huge fire truck ladder. Okay, I'm looking out my window like this. The ladders are going right for my window. I'm going, my room's on fire. I'm sure. There's nothing on fire. I can't find anything. I'm the window, I'm standing there, like, and the thing in the hotel starts going off, babe, leave immediately, vacate the premises. Some jerk set the hotel on fire, and it was you. That's what I was hearing, they were really saying that. So I'm like, I know this is, somehow this is my fault. And I get into the hall, and there's all these fans from the concert, everybody's in the hall. Okay, anybody there? You guys weren't there? And anyway, the halls were packed. Everybody's like, half of them are in their jammies and half of them are still up. And I'm like, hey man, hey, you want a concert for me? I'm walking out, I'm like, I'm sorry, you guys. I still thought it was my fault. And so then I went downstairs. Dad, this is a long story. I got downstairs and we're outside. It's like daylight. Oh, God, it's horrible. And everybody's standing around that's going to be at the concert the next day. And I'm like talking to people. I'm like, hey. And then I see Paige. So I run over to Paige. And I'm like, I was up in my room. I saw the fire trucks are coming and everything. And I was like, the first thought I had was, I'm sure this was my fault. And he goes, oh my God, I had the exact same thought. I was sure it was your fault. Including the long trail part about the ring. We were hiking up the long trail, and I just suddenly thought I wanted to ask Sue to marry me, but I didn't have a ring. And so the whole way up the mountain, we were going up the back of Stowe, you know, back of Mount Mansfield. It takes about 4 hours. I was weaving her ring out of like a little piece of grass. I'm getting a ring.
She was like, that's it? That's so lame. Oh, I'll marry you anyway. Say this without, okay. So this story was, something about the ocean made me think about this story because it took place at the ocean. The ocean is only a lot of drops of water, but this is about my amazing mom, this story. Now, my mom is gonna probably read about this online. So mom, I'm saying to you through the wires of the internet, I know she doesn't like me talking about her too much, but I happen to have the coolest mom who has ever lived. She's badass. And I feel very grateful for that fact, to have such a cool mom. But my mom is not afraid to. So one time we were in Marco Island, this is the story. Sorry, mom. Which is, you know, Florida, Marco Island. And we're like walking down the street. I'm pushing the baby carriage with one of my daughters was a baby, and maybe one was like a toddler, and she was with us, and my mom's with us. And I'm walking down the street, and I'm pushing the baby carriage, and it's like a thin little sidewalk. And this guy is walking by, and he's got like a pink, like eyes out shirt on. He's kind of a muscly guy, and he's kind of like a dude. And he's walking along, I'm walking next to my mom, and as he walks by, he bumps into my mom on his shoulder. And he knocks her shoulder back. She's, you know, grandma. And I said, hey, man. You know, he kind of walks past. My mom is really mad. She said, what was that all about? Like, he pushes past the baby carriage and knocks the grandmother out of the way. He's all gritting his teeth, you know. And he's all angry. And, you know, we're sort of walking along. I'm like, it's cool, mom. Don't worry about it. She's like, no, that really makes me mad. She was just so mad. And she's stomping around really mad. We went back. And we were staying in this, like, sort of like a rental apartment. And we go back to the apartment. And we're, I just realized, and she's going to hear me telling the story. We go back to the apartment, and she's still mad. And you know when you're mad, kind of clumsy things happen? So she's walking around all mad, and there's this big plate glass window that goes out to the porch. And she, like, walks right into it really hard. This guy, this jerk, and she's like, boom! Bang! Split her nose, and blood is just gushing everywhere. Mom. Right? And so they're just, I'm getting towels and they're all full of blood and there's blood all over the place. And then she's like, wait a minute. She's like, I got an idea. Get the key car keys. I'm like, mom. And so we get in the car and she starts looking for the guy. She's driving around with the bloody towels and she's like laughing. This is my mom. She's like, oh my God, this is going to be great. She's all like, so excited. Blood everywhere, bloody towels, blood all over her dress and everything. She's like, this is awesome. Man. So we're driving around looking for a guy with a pink lacoste shirt. And then we find him. She sees him. He's talking to his wife and a couple of friends. It's sort of like a, Marco Island's kind of like, almost like a golf kind of vibe. If you picture, you know, like a retirement kind of golf vibe. Whatever that is, you know, older. And so he's got that big shirt and he's talking in a nice circle with like some nice older people, one of whom is his wife. And my mom's like, but mom, I'm like, mom, I don't know if I feel good about this. And she's like, go. And so I pull over the car and she jumps out and she runs up and she's like, look what you did to me. And then she says to the wife, she's like, look what your husband did to me. And so the woman starts like saying stuff like that with the bloody towels. And I'm kind of meekly hovering behind her. And I walk over and I look over her shoulder and I'm like, it's not the guy. It's totally not the guy. She's like the same shirt. And the guy is mortified. And his wife is staring at him like, what did you do? What's your husband? What have you done? And my mom is saying, get the pencil, I'm gonna write down your name. And I don't even remember how we got out of there, but I think we just left.
comment. My mom and I used to write songs together. My first professional gig was writing songs for my mom. We used to write them. My mom's the editor of Sesame Street magazine. Very creative person. Great writer. She did many books. And my grandmother was a writer too. So a lot of creative people in the family. And my mom and I used to get $250 to write children's songs, like flat out. And this one.
Play one.
And one of them was like,
"You can do it."
They were like kindergartners. I remember one of them, "Find your own space." And I've had so much fun. I'm going to play a song that I played last night. I don't know if there's people over there.
Bring fish here!
Okay. Shout out my friend Tom Marshall, dearest friend, because that song says so much about him. It's just, I love it. You know, it's a very short list. There's only one thing on the list of my best friends. That is pure Tom right there. Now that says only as much about Tom as this next song. So this next song, Tom used to work at ETS, which is actually where my father worked too, which is where they make SATs. And he and his boss didn't get along at all. And so this next song is about his boss. And there was like, at work, there was this sort of walkway that he could walk around, and like on break. And he got caught out there one time. He was like, supposed to have a 15-minute break. It was like 20 minutes or something. This guy used to get in trouble all the time and get really mad. So the guy that was his boss also happened to be an owl enthusiast. And so Tom told me that the two of them had running into each other on this path, and he had tried awkwardly to make conversation with him, which went nowhere. We used to play here all the time in like 1990 and 91, and I don't know why we stopped coming so much. I was really excited to come here today. So thank you for having me. I don't know if any of you were there, but or were that old, unless you probably weren't even born in the 90s. We used to play there with, that was the first place that I met all the Aquarian Rescue Unit guys who used to play. And we became very good friends. And we met Bruce there. That's where I met at the Georgia, well, there being the Georgia Theater. I actually met Bruce at 40 Watt when we were playing at the Georgia. Is that still there? Okay. We came down in 90 and 91 and played numerous shows at the Georgia Theater. And I remember one night playing there, and I think we were actually playing with Widespread back then in 1990, and walking over with Dave, and he's like, "I gotta see this band, man," and
I went over to 40 Watt. There's like 10 people in the audience. And it was Jeff Seit, Ateel, Matt Mundy, Jimmy Harry, and Bruce, and Reverend Mosier. And this band is just like slaying. And it was like me and Dave and like five other people standing there. It was incredible band. And then we met Bruce, and then we ended up touring a lot with the Aquarius. We did a lot of tours. And that was really, really good times. I'm sorry to wax nostalgic here, but let me just share one more story. It's just a little thing I was thinking about when I drove in. I have this memory of playing at the Georgia Theater, and Michael Hazard, who used to play guitar, he was backstage, and you know, like, we were never close friends or anything like that. We weren't like, but we were, you know, I met him enough to, you know, hang out, and I have such a nice memory. He was such a nice guy, like just a kind, quiet, sweet guy. He used to play, for those who never got a chance to see him, he used to play with, he had a Marshall amp, very loud, and he used to face, when we played with him, with his back to the audience, he was very super shy, had big hair, he would put his hair down, kind of, and he had this little piece of paper on his amp that said, "I am not afraid." And he would face his amp, and I just loved his playing, like his whole spirit. So I just wanted to say, as we drove into town, I remembered hanging out with him backstage, and I'm grateful for that memory. So anyway, it's great to be here again, and you should invite us back more, guys. Come on, let's go. What's up? I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed, so. But did you know that the atmosphere is a fluid? Did you know that? You didn't, did you? Did you know that the atmosphere is a fluid? You did? I didn't know that. But I was thinking, if the atmosphere is a fluid, and the ocean is a fluid, and two fluids rubbing together, makes friction, which is waves. I'm not gonna play waves. That's not what I was getting at. I was really just thinking about it. I was just thinking about, like, maybe I'm going too far with this whole TED talk about science. Or whatever I'm doing up here. Like, that's science, what I'm just saying. As much as I know about science. I blinded me. Science. But I was just thinking, if the two fluids are rubbing together, think about this for a minute, it's incredible. Right? Exchanging, as we say, fluids. And they're crashing against the earth. Right? And the waves are crashing against the earth. And that's, you know, because I'm wondering, like, why does the beach sound so good when you're there? It's like the greatest sound. And that, it's like the sound of home, which is water, right? This is the kind of stuff I think about. Man, I'm so sorry about it. I'm going down a horrible tangent here. But no, really. Okay, well, like, if you put a fire on the beach, right? Now you've got fire, the sound of the bonfire on the beach, and you've got fluid rubbing in the tube. And then the sound waves don't travel through space. Like, sound waves don't travel through space. They need a medium. So they need water or air or earth or a tree, which is what I'm playing right here. I need a tree to travel through. But they won't travel in space. In space, no one can hear you scream. Go somewhere on this. I don't know where. Anyway, so the long and short of it is that the beach sounds good. That's horrible. But it's true. Come on.
man. Oh, yeah. This is it. I go home after this. The tour is over. And I had such a good time. I wish I could keep going. Can I just stay here? So I'm just going to keep playing all these songs before I... I love this song. I said this a couple nights ago, but I'll say it again. I wrote this sitting on the floor I had a sort of a book of little Tom's stuff, and then I would kind of add my own, I'd like kind of add a verse. But anyway, I wrote this sitting on the floor in my bedroom in 1995, about 3 days before my first daughter was born. She's 22 years old now. So I think about Sue, my wife Sue, when I sing this song. I think about that. I just remember it so clearly. I feel really blessed to have met such a cool person. Still cool. Thank you.